Thanks so much for joining us today. We'd love to know how God is using this ministry to touch your life. So please take a moment and send us your story by going to christianliferantoul.com and clicking Amen Central. Thanks again for joining us, and we hope you enjoyed today's message.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. What a great auditorium, sanctuary, facility. I'm so glad to be with you these next few days. And I walked into this place, the foyer, and then into the sanctuary. It just looks so wonderful. The lights, the stage, the work that has been done. It's so beautiful. But like your pastor said, I saw it not just so much from an aesthetic value, but I saw it in the spirit. Change, transformation, restoration, renovation, renewal. God's doing something in the spirit. What we see in the natural is just a parallel truth to what's happening in the spirit. And something is going to be downloaded in your life that is going to be bring transformation, renewal, restoration, revival. Hallelujah. Our nation is changing. Something's happening in the spirit, not just a change of presidency, but there's a release of faith in the church. I don't know if you've noticed that there's just been this isn't just a political change that is taking place, but it's a spiritual change that is taking place, and land that has been lost is about to be reclaimed. And so what's happening in the government, what's happening in the nation, what's happening in the church is all parallel. And so what's happening here and there is going to be happening in you and in your family. Hallelujah. Restoration, renewal, transformation. God's glory is going to not only fill this house, but is going to fill your house. And is going to fill your body, your soul, your spirit. Are you ready for God to just break forth and break through in you, and He's going to shine upon you, and you're going to shine in society, and God is going to just be glorified in and through our God-hungry lives. Hallelujah. I want to pray, and then we're going to get into the Word. Let me just hit this little button here and remind myself of something called time. Praise the Lord. I got so excited, I forgot about that. Let's pray. Our Father, who is in heaven, ruler of the universe, creator, hallowed be your name. Be glorified in this place and in our lives today as we step into this renewed sanctuary and facility, God. Come in your power and your majesty and renew us, refresh us, restore us, diseased bodies restored to health, lukewarm hearts restored to fire and passion, weak lives made strong. God, what we see in the natural, do in the spiritual, in us and then for us. And then most of all, through us, to our nation, O God. Your kingdom come, let your rule, let your reign, let your government be established, O God, in our lives this day. Manifest your power, your kingdom authority, your will be done as we sang, O God, on earth, but your will be done not only what has already taken place and established in heaven, let it manifest on earth, but bring it right down to our lives, O God. Your will be done in us. Everything that resists your will, let those things come down. And, O God, your will be established in our lives. Give us this day our daily bread, just as you supplied manna every day for the children in the wilderness. O God, give us this day that which is required to sustain and strengthen our lives. Supply for those who are in lack. Supply for those who are in need. O God, physically, mentally, relationally, but O God, especially today in your word, give us your word for this day. that will establish and strengthen our lives. And, oh God, please forgive us our debts for those that we owe to. Forgive us as we even forgive those who have harmed us. Lead us not into temptation, O God, but cause us to be strong in a world with so many deceptions around us, that we may be established upon the rock. Deliver us from the evil one. You have given us, O God, the armor of light, that we may shine. And today we want to stand strong against all the forces that wage war against your church and against our lives, that we would stand in your victory. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. And everyone said, amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. I chose the subject for these few meetings entitled Shine, because I believe it is the, someone once said, when the world is at its darkest, the church will be at its brightest. And I believe that we are living in dark days, but these are our days to shine. And I believe that the influence of the church and the influence of your life is going to make a difference in this world that is so dark. We have not just been chosen to be saved from hell to make heaven, but we've been chosen by God to be bright lights that shine in the midst of a wicked and perverse generation, that He has saved you, that the light of God's glory in you would be seen like a city on a hillside that cannot be hid. It is our time to shine. Can you say amen?
Amen.
When God created the heavens and the earth, as you know, the earth was void and the Spirit was hovering over the deep. And then God said, let there be not joy, peace, health, prosperity, love. But He said what? Let there be light. Hallelujah. The first words God uttered in the universe was, let there be light. And whenever change is needed, the lights must come on. Shining bright. For life to exist, there must be light. For faith to exist, there must be light, revelation, glory. And for change to take place, there must be light. And the first words God said, the divine, the greatest authority, when He said, let there be light, literally it means light exist. And God, who is light, caused light to fill the universe. Hallelujah. And so we see light right at the very beginning. In Genesis chapter 1, the very first words that God declared in the universe, light exists, everything must emanate from that light. There is no doubt about it, we are living in dark days, dark times. And in Isaiah chapter 60 and verses 1 and 2, it says, arise, shine, for your light has come. And the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth. So when the church and the people of God shine is when there is darkness all around. And so just as God said, let there be light in this void, in this chaos, in this disorder, light came bringing life and order. Now God's life and light is revealed through yielded lives. Hallelujah. Arise, take your place, shine. Don't be ashamed, don't be embarrassed. Even though the world is dark and everything is gloomy and spells of danger, risk, death, this is our time to shine. For deep darkness, the people, but the Lord will rise over you, and His glory, His brilliance will be seen upon you. Hallelujah. One of the greatest portions of Scripture. arise, shine. And that's God's call for us today as well, just as it was for them in Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 and 2. People say we live in the darkest of days. There have been dark days throughout the history of mankind. I know I was not alive. I was not even, as they would say, twinkling in my parents' eyes at that stage. But World War II was a very dark period of time in world history. World War I, Vietnam, was a very dark time. And there is no doubt that people suffered horrifically in those conditions. We today in the United States of America, we say it's very dark, but there have been very dark times. And I remember when 9/11 was a very dark day, probably the darkest day I've ever experienced in my life, seeing so many people right in your living room perish before your eyes. It was a very dark day in our history. But we're living in dark times. This isn't foreign. It's always been dark. But when you look at statistics, world statistics, I know we work in an area in India called Maharashtra, 40,000 villages, millions of people in darkness. And it's as if the government is doing its utmost to stop the church and missionaries to come in. 40,000 villages and a handful of churches, just a handful of church buildings, let alone churches. But then we're able to get in there. And even though it's very dark and it's impenetrable in the natural, our missionaries go in and they can't even preach. They have to go in and pray in homes. But when you go into the home, suddenly 40, 50 people come into those little houses. And then they start to tell the stories of Jesus, of his power. And their hearts that have been blinded and darkened are suddenly invaded by the light of the glory of God as the word is spoken. And then it's as if they're living in the book of Acts. Miracles are taking place. People are being delivered from demons. People are being healed. Instant manifestations of God's glory. So it doesn't matter how dark it is. When Christians step into that environment, light is invading the darkness. The darkness is not invading the light. We are pushing it back. And suddenly, even though when you look at statistics again, 1. almost 3 billion people with a minimal percentage, maybe perhaps 2% born again. How many of you know we have a huge task to invade a nation such as India that has been gripped in darkness from the beginnings of time? And yet, we don't lose heart because even though it's very dark and it's resistant, and the government is opposing, nothing can stop the invasion of God's love and light and power. There isn't a force strong enough to stop what God has already established. For when he said, "Let there be light," light existed. And now we, the light bearers or the light carriers, when we step into any scenario, regardless of how dark it is, change comes. Hallelujah. You are a carrier of God's light. I was just reading statistics concerning how dark it is. This very week, last week, these came out, these numbers. Did you know that last year, over 90,000 followers of Christ were martyred? 90,000. 90,000 Christians. How many of you know if there was your father, mother, son, daughter, you would think these are pretty dark days? And it is true. It's as if the devil knows that his time is short and he's doing his utmost to prevent the church from making its stand, especially in these Islamic nations where radical Islam, this is where the bulk of it was taking place, North Korea, Afghanistan, Iraq, Iran, India, certainly one of the highest places of persecution and resistance. But the truth is, they again, last week I read that America has become listed as one of the persecuted nations. Do you understand how significant that is? It is dark. Everyone is wanting to mute our voice, silence the gospel. They want to put the lights off to prevent us from having our say so that anything can go. But you and I, we've made a stand. We're taking this land back for the glory of God. And the gospel will not be muted and the lights won't go off, because even though it is dark and there is resistance, we're not stopped. We're not stopped. Let me tell you, these who gave their lives, they will receive the martyr's crown, that even though it may be dark for their families and those who remain, they are in the glories of eternity. The church is indestructible. The gates of hell will not prevail. Even though it is dark, the church will shine. Even though we are resisted, we will not be stopped. Did you know that about 44 people are murdered in the United States every day? I read another statistic just this week that if they could remove the cities of Detroit, Memphis, Oakland, and St. Louis, we'd be one of the safest countries in the world. Someone also included Chicago, I believe, in their statistics, which is, but when I researched that those were the highest cities of murders in our great country. But did you know that there are 12,000 terror attacks worldwide last year? 12,000 terror attacks, 28,000 deaths due to terror attacks. How many of you know these are dark days? And our own nation is suffering. People are being killed in nightclubs, in places of business. People are killed in university in Kenya because of radical Islam. They want to stop, and they targeted Christians. Are you a Christian? And they refuse to deny their faith. They were killed. And so this is happening. It is dark. Disease is, no matter how far we advance in science and technology, people are dying just as much in previous times, so fast we can barely keep up. I don't know, a couple of years ago, and some of you will remember the story, that my son was stricken with a disease that paralyzed him. God raised him, but I chose that my ministry would be a place of prayer, praying for the suffering and the sick. We, through technology, we communicate to our 500 intercessors the different prayer needs. To tell you the truth, when my phone beeps and reminds me that there's a new prayer request, my heart sinks again, because someone is in pain, agony, ICU, kids committing suicide, parents left devastated. How many of you know we are living in pretty dark days? Addictions, alcoholism, addictions to food, to pornography, is destroying families, destroying health, destroying people's lives, their well-being. People are in darkness all around us. People, even with all of our technologies and advances, are still in many nations unable to have access to education, access to safe drinking water, access to electricity, access to food. How many of you know if you were in one of those countries, you would be living in a pretty dark place? One of our missions teams went into Ethiopia last year, in a region we're working with about 14 unreached tribes. And last year, we discipled 25 imams, leaders of the mosques, that turned to Christ We discipled them through our intensive boot camp for discipleship and then leadership so that they could go back into their communities carrying the gospel. Dark, the hotbed of terrorism in Africa, that's where these organizations are basing in the Horn of Africa. And even though it's dark, when the word, when the power of God is preached, light invades those villages where the gospel has never been preached. There are no churches, there are no Bibles, but light comes even though it's dark. It is not impenetrable. It is not unstoppable. The kingdom of God, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Carriers of kingdom light are coming in and taking charge of those situations. One of my sons in the Lord, I led him to the Lord at 13. Some of you may know the organization, Philip Smethurst from Overland Missions. He came to America with me. We launched global ministries together. But part of that was to do what we call overland, taking teams into Africa, into these villages and areas. Eventually, it grew so big that we released it into its own ministry and we launched Overland Missions. Phil has done a tremendous job and raised up a great organization. I'm still chairman of the board from its beginning to now. But one of the young people, 23-year-old young man working in the villages of Africa, goes in and he does a pastor's conference. You say, well, what does a 23-year-old have to say to a pastor's conference? Well, these are village pastors. They've barely got Bibles, let alone Bible education, but they've got churches. They're hungry for God. This young man begins to teach on the book of Acts, what Jesus both began to teach and to do, and spoke about the book of Acts never had an amen. That when the apostles died, there was not a cessation of the power of God, that his gifts and his glory is still accessible and available to all men everywhere. And within that ministry group was a denominational pastor that had been somewhat taught that these things don't take place. And he sat there listening to the word, and you will know that the entrance of God's word brings light, understanding, revelation. He's sitting there, but he's confused because someone has told him this doesn't take place. And here's a young kid in sandals, shorts, and a t-shirt telling him that this is accessible. This is still true today. So he goes home. And his young daughter is pregnant, and there's complications, and that night she dies, about midnight. All the family gather, they light the fires, the people start, all the mourners start to come, as is traditional in Africa. Immediately, everyone is there, all the villagers there. They start to mourn her death. The baby is not born. She is dead. About 5 hours, she's been lying dead, and the mourners are gathering. The pastor suddenly recalls what this young missionary kid said, that what God did has never stopped. And he wondered if it is possible that he could go into that room and raise his daughter, who's been dead for 5 hours, if he could raise her. So he steps into that room and he ushers everyone out and he tells the mourners to stop mourning. And he calls on the name of Jesus and commands life, or commands light, to enter her dead body, and in one split second, she is raised from the dead. Life conquers death, and light dispels darkness, and she was raised, and that baby was born, and they are both alive and serving God. Yeah. just a young kid, about 23 years old, as a carrier of light into a dark region. But that light didn't stop there. That man, when he heard that God is working like he did in the book of Acts, had to do something with the light. You can't just have light. Light is activated. Light is released. And he released light into that dark room on that dark night. And light pushed back darkness. Hallelujah. I was in the conference with Overland just a few days ago, and Phil was telling the story. And then this week, I was in Connecticut. One of my missionaries who lives in Connecticut, travels Africa and India, preaching with our teams, came to my meetings, and she said, and I was telling the story, and she says, I've got a video of this event. I've got a video of this girl testifying. I've got a video of the baby. I've held the baby. I've blessed the baby. I've got a video of the dad. I was there. Hallelujah. This is not just hearsay. We have record of this event. People may say, well, that's darkest Africa. No, this will work in darkest America as well. In fact, I somewhat think Africa is brighter than America. Hallelujah. There is such fast church growth. I was with Rodney a few days ago, Rodney Howard Brown, and he had just got back from South Africa. And young people, their churches are 60, 70,000 strong. There's one man in Nigeria, ministry is just 15 years old. He has a city with two universities where his churches are stadiums. There's no building big enough, and they meet 24 hours. There's always a meeting. They can never stop meeting because they can't accommodate the crowd. How many of you know that light penetrates darkness? And even where there is deep darkness covering the earth, when the church arises and shines and people say, here I am, God, use me. How many of you know that God will take that person and that light is unstoppable? Hallelujah. It works not just in Africa. It doesn't just work in India in a little village, but it works right here in the United States of America. Hallelujah. Shine. It is our time to shine. Can you say amen? Amen. But you are a chosen generation, the Bible says, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We are carriers of his marvelous light. And as we go, so God's glory goes with us, even into a little Zambian village, into a little Zambian hut, with a little Zambian pastor and a dead daughter. That light will travel into that realm and bring God's love and God's grace. That pastor had to do something with the light he got. And here's the problem. Sometimes we receive the light, but we do nothing with it. That's why I said shine. You have to shine. You've got to do something with what you've got. It's not just something that exists. You got to do something with it. Light brings change. Light brings life. Light brings growth. Light brings faith. But it has to be activated. It has to be acted upon. In Matthew chapter 5, well-known portion of Scripture in verses 14 and 16, you are the light of the world. How did Jesus describe himself? He said, I am the light of the world. And then he says this outrageous statement that is almost, how do you even comprehend this? He calls us what he is. It seems almost blasphemous to assume this, but that's exactly what the master, the teacher of all teachers said. You are the light of the world. The light of the world calls his followers the light of the world. God is light, and he says to his people, you are not only carriers of his light, but you are the light of the world. I could understand Jesus saying, I am the light of the world, represent me. I am the light of the world, talk about my light. But he doesn't say, I am the light of the world and you can just talk about it. He says, you are the light. That's a wow. That's powerful. As he is, so are we. Not in the sweet by and by, pie in the sky, but in the here and now. Hallelujah. Come on, give God a shout of praise. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot. I had a look at what the Greek for cannot means. Guess what it is? You're a smart man. It cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, or as you would say, a basket. Or under a bowl, or under a cover. Light is not meant to be hidden. Light is to be revealed. I was in military operations somewhere in the world, which I can't declare to you. And I was in the middle of the bush, and there were enemy all around me. But it was crazy. When I looked towards the horizon, I felt so far away from everything and everyone. And yet, in the horizon, I could see a great city. Its lights were shining. And even though I was in the middle of the bush, in the middle of nowhere, surrounded by enemies, I could see the light of a city. And I lay there in my position, thinking about, there are people at home in their beds watching television, reading books, hugging and loving their kids. And here I am in a stinking foxhole about to have bullets and mortars and rockets all around me. And yet so close in this darkness where I can't even see them, there is a whole city back there and life is going on. You know, light is an amazing thing. It can't be hidden. Have you ever had a look at the earth when they take pictures at night of like the east coast of America? Or you see the Africa, you can see where all the cities are. You get Sahara Desert and there's like one little glimmering light in the middle of thousands and thousands of miles of non-existence of life form as we would know it. Of course, there's life there. There are little critters and stuff. But it's just desert. You can travel from hours and hours and hours in a plane, and it's just desert. And then you come to one little village, and there's a few lights on, and even from 30,000 feet, you can see the light. Hallelujah. You can't hide the light. It must shine. You got to let it out. He says, but you put it on a lampstand and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. In other words, our light is not just who we are and what we possess, but it is visible. It reveals God, our actions, our words, our faith, what we do. The light has to be released. It can't just be contained for our comfort. You are the light of the world, but it's for purpose, so that people will glorify your Father who is in heaven. That pastor could have kept his light. I believe that God is the same. What he did, he's doing. But he had to release it. He had to speak it. He had to do something with what he had. And that's my challenge to us today, that we've got to do something with what we have. He could have hidden it, but then his daughter would never have been raised. Their lives wouldn't have been changed. His ministry wouldn't have been activated to its full potential. He would have just stayed in the knowledge of Acts chapter 1, that what Jesus began both to teach and do. I can do it. I could do it. I should do it. And some people, that's what they do with their faith, with their knowledge, with their revelation. They just sit on it. It's like this little secret thing they have. But light must shine. Light must do something with it. You've got to do something with it. You've got to speak it. You've got to prophesy it. You've got to pray it. You've got to press through the barriers that want to stop you and silence you, because light always wins. When that daughter lay in utter darkness, no matter how dark it was, the light won. Light will win. There is a challenge against the light in our lives. I want to quote to you 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 19. And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns in the morning and the star rises in your hearts. We have to let it manifest, and we become persuaded of that revelation, of that light. It's got to rise in us for it to shine through us. You have to be persuaded by it. And when I saw this verse, I saw that the light has been challenged. We have to remove anything that prevents our lives from shining. We got to remove the bowl. We got to remove the cover. For the love and the light of God to be revealed through our lives, anything that stops it has to be removed. Apathy, complacency, indifference, and fear needs to be replaced with faith and a God confidence. Uncommitted hearts have to become committed, otherwise the light will never truly reach its full potential. We need to lay claim of our position in God, because there is not only just our own resistance, our natural being, our fears, and our busyness and the clutter of our lives, but there is a vicious enemy that wants to switch off the lights. There is a spiritual battle raging for the light. Ephesians 13 and verse 2 says that we are to put on the armor of light. Why? Because the enemy, who is the ultimate force of darkness, has to be withstood. And the way you withstand the enemy is with the armor of light. Or as Ephesians 6 says, the armor of God. You put on the armor of light to resist the forces of darkness. And so it's something that you put on. It's not something that you just look at occasionally. You put it on. You wear this armor of light because there is an enemy that wants to switch you off, who wants to stop your light from affecting people that they may glorify your Father who is in heaven. Just like there was a Goliath challenging the armies of Israel. Just like there was a Jezebel attacking the prophetic word, How many of you know that these natural enemies that Israel faced, that we, the Bible says, wrestle not against flesh and blood, we also face Goliaths, we also face Jezebels, we also face Amalekites. There are natural enemies that they faced, but those natural enemies were really just a front for the spiritual enemy that was wanting to destroy the witness or the revelation of God's redemption through Israel. And now God's redemption to the world is released through this, his people, his body, the church. And you're a member of it. You're a part of it. And so the enemies of our generation, the Goliaths, the Jezebels of our generation, want to violate our faith, our witness, silence us and stop us, and therefore we must be adequately clothed. The enemy wants to stop us from shining. But the God who said, "Let there be light," who took the chaos and brought order, is the one who shines in us. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 6. "For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Hallelujah. The God of creation is the God of the new creation. And just as he said, "Let there be light," and light existed, is the one that said to your life and my life, "Let there be light." And Jesus Christ was revealed. Hallelujah. In John chapter 1 and verses 1 to 5, "In the beginning was the Word. Let there be. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him nothing was made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it." Or the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. Darkness cannot extinguish light unless we allow it. And that's the challenge that we have to face. There is no darkness strong enough to put out the light. The darkness tried to silence and put out the light of Jesus. But on the third day, he rose again and is alive forevermore. Hallelujah. "This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. And therefore we must prevent our lives from having darkness." Is there anything bringing darkness into your life that is stopping the light from shining? Is there compromise? Is there an area of your life that you have not exposed to the glory of God that is limiting the force of faith being activated in you and through you? Is there complacency? Is there spiritual indifference? Is there a backing away from the things of God? Well, I want to be God's voice to you today, the one who said, "Let there be light," and light existed. The darkness that is over your life right now can be broken. That thing can be removed, and you can have a breakthrough, a deliverance from that bondage, from that habit, from that limitation that is stopping your faith from fully activating. John the Baptist put it this way. He said, "I must decrease. For the light to shine, you must decrease. You must give God his rightful place." You remember when Jesus was born and the word got out to the king, King Herod. What did he want to do? He wanted to kill all the potential kings, because you can't have two people on a throne. You understand? You can't have two people on the throne. There can only be one. And the challenge is, can you get off the throne of your will? Can you decrease that he might increase? Can he take his rightful place? For the church to reach its potential, we have to rid ourselves of selfishness, self-rule, self-government, and allow the authority of God to be established in our hearts. This is what is stopping the force of faith from being activated in the church. This is what's limiting prayers. This is what's limiting the glory from being released in this nation, is selfishness. We must decrease. He must increase. We must become nothing so that he may become everything. We must lie low so that he alone may be lifted high and draw all men to himself. Can you say amen? The Bible put it this way: you cannot serve two gods. There's no place for a foreign god. I will only bow my knee to him and say, Jesus is Lord, take your rightful place, and then you will shine. Let's stand and let's pray. Let there be light. Is any darkness? Is anything in your life that is stopping the light? Is there that compromise? Is that indifference? Is there that apathy? Is that your own thing has so distracted you from the Word of God, from the power of God, that you wrapped up in yourself? This is where I want to begin today, with a fresh allegiance to his rule in our lives. And then tonight we'll be laying hands on people, releasing the anointing, the light and the life of God to flow into your body, soul and spirit to bring radical and powerful change. But I need to start with the condition of our heart. Is there anyone here that has come today that Jesus is not the Lord of your life? You are on the throne and he is not on the throne. I want to pray for you right now. Leon, I need to get my life right with God. I need to get back into divine order, the chaos. Let there be light. The light has come to me, and I want him to take his rightful place. Leon, please pray for me. Raise your hand. I will see it, and I'm going to pray for you. And that includes you at home that's watching right now. You can be a part of this prayer. God can deal with you and work with you right now. Where is the camera? Is that it over there? I'm looking there. Right now in your home, God can touch you as well, watching, whether it's a recording later on or right now live. God will touch you. I see a number of hands raised. Will you? Who else? Leon, I need to step away from my compromise, from my apathy, my spiritual indifference. I need to get back with God. I need to get to the rightful place. I need the light of God to shine. All right. All around, hands have been raised. God is about to radically change your life. Everyone, would you please pray this prayer with me, and especially those who have raised your hands, make this your prayer to your God. Lord God Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, you said, let there be light, and light existed. And now your light has come to me. Take your rightful place. Shine in me and shine through me. I turn from my thing, and I give you the rule of my heart, and I give you the rule of my life. I am yours. You have won my heart. Shine in me and shine through me in Jesus' name. Now, Lord God, please touch every life here. Touch them, fill them, change them. Let this be a new day of new beginnings, breakthroughs, healings, miracles, fullness of your spirit, refreshing, renewal, restoration, revival, oh God, where we're at. Some in the shallow end, take them into the deep end. Those in the deep end, take them even deeper still. Those who are weak, oh God, cause your strength to enter them. And those that are strong, please make them stronger still. Those who are weak in faith, increase, add to, strengthen. And those who are strong, oh God, let mountains move. and the climate of our nation be changed through their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thanks for joining us today. If you have any questions or want more information, please visit ChristianLifeRenewal.com.